We'll call the May 27th meeting of Caroline County Board of Supervisors to order. Let the record state that all board members are present. Mr. Taylor representing Port Royal, Mr. Black representing Western Caroline, Mr. Underwood representing Reedy Church, Mr. Akers representing Madison, Mr. Seeley representing Bowling Green, and I'm Floyd Thomas representing Mattapani. At this point in time, I have asked Mr. Taylor if he would deliver the invocation for us. Mr. Taylor?
Let's bow our heads, please. Our Father in heaven, we come to thee at this hour thanking thee for all of their blessings. We thank thee for this opportunity to meet and to discuss those things that prove to be beneficial to Caroline County. We ask thee for wisdom and guidance, and may all the accomplishments that may occur as a result of what we do, may we give the Lord Jesus Christ the praise and thanks. These and all the blessings we ask in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Cully, any amendments to the agenda tonight?
No, sir.
No amendments. The agenda will stand as presented. Opening board comments, Mr. Taylor?
Yes, Mr. Thomas, just a couple of. I just want to, let the board know that there is a proposal, or I guess a request, to close the Port Royal post office. And I am concerned about that, as many of the citizens of that area are retired citizens. That is the only post office in that area. So if this were to take place, then those citizens would either have to, I would imagine, go to Bowling Green or maybe King George. I'm not sure what the alternative would be, but I would ask, if nothing more, as we find out more about this proposal, maybe we could write some type of letter in support of keeping it open, if nothing else. I realize it is the federal government and we don't have any real control over that, but for what it's worth, to represent the citizens down there and to do what we can do to try to assist, if there's something we can do to keep it open, I would like to see us do that. And the only other announcement I have is I would like to congratulate two students at the middle school. One is Aaron Taylor, and the other is Zach Hall. Those two students are members of the Beta Club and the National Junior Honor Society. And when our young people do well, I think it's nice to say congratulations. That's all I have.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. Mr. Black?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, thank you. I have several. First of all, I would like to thank Mr. Ron Curlings and all of those who put on the Memorial Day ceremony yesterday in Bowling Green. It was a fabulous ceremony. The speech about the role of women in the military and what role women have served in the United States military since its inception was kind of fascinating. It was a beautiful ceremony, and it would be nice to get lots more people in the county out to that. I would also like to thank those constituents who came out to my meetings last week with a variety of questions. They had a variety of questions, so special thanks to those who showed up. Something else, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to, with your permission, maybe start looking at in the county. I was driving by about a week ago towards the Food Lion Ladysmith, and I noticed that there was people, kids, playing soccer in the park there off, basically right off Ladysmith Road, and the grass was basically about hip high. And same thing with the softball field. And I'm not sure if it's the school system who mows that or it's the county in charge of that. We've spent a lot of money on a YMCA, and I just think that there are certain things that we could do in this county as far as parks outside during the summer, ball fields and so forth. I've originally talked to Mr. Cully about this a little bit. possibly Mr. Whiteman. I'm not talking about a lot of tax money obviously going into this, but what we can kind of feasibly look into to try to help the citizens, especially different parts of the county, not just in Ladysmith, but around to improve parks in the county where people have recreational places to go to outside and don't need a membership. So I think that's something that we could possibly take a look at. If that's okay with you, that's...
Sure.
Okay. The next thing, and I've had several questions, and I think you're the, Mr. Chairman, you're the one who's working on this. Several phone calls regarding rural internet, and I didn't really know. I just said kind of forwarded them to you, just kind of what the situation was that. I know you had talked to the last meeting. Several people in the Childsburg area, you know, they still, if you're not in a major subdivision, you're not served by the cable. So, you know, I think they want to see what exactly is going on in the county with that. So I gave them your number, but it would also kind of, as a board, to have some sort of update to what's going on there, that would be great. The other thing too, and that we had mentioned with the school board, when we met with the school board, and I think now would be the time to start with it. Dr. Kulo seemed to be in favor of doing this when we talked to him, and I think now that we have his favor, is that combined maintenance. We had talked about the possibility of a combined maintenance facility. If we could set up something with them to start looking into exactly the cost-benefit analysis and so forth of that, would be beneficial to both us. When you look at the warrant sometimes and how much we're paying and repairs to different shops in the county, might be just something for us to take a look at. So, and then finally, the last thing I have is at the last meeting, we had talked about looking at the SE, I guess, for Abundant Life Academy for children who had apparently escaped from the county or escaped from that facility. I think that we're setting a bad precedent by possibly threatening to pull an SE or looking at the special exception, because if we do for one, then we're going to have to do for all. So I have asked to look at in different places where we've given special exceptions where people have possibly violated, because then what we're going to have to do is, if we do it for Abundant Life Academy, we're going to have to do it for every single one, and I think we'll get bogged down in meetings every time someone violates a special exception. So I'm not sure that we want to set that precedent. No frowns on our face at all here, just I don't think we want to set that precedent in the county. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Black. Mr. Underwood?
Just to Mr. Chairman, I want to thank the Mr. Cully for having the county respond to the issue over at the park at dawn. They needed the gravel replaced. I sure appreciate that. Second comment is, you know, we've talked about the water break issue in Caroline Pines. I understand we had another water break last week. So I do think we need to come to the table and let's talk about that with the folks at Caroline Pines. And Mr. Cully and Mr. Schiebel and I, we met 2 weeks ago, but I think we need to come back to the table so they clearly understand that there is a plan, and so we don't just arbitrarily make a decision, but they have an understanding of what we're looking at in terms of cost to the county. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Akers?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In reference to Mr. Black and his comment on ALA, I think I was the one that asked staff to look at this and to get to bring them to the board. It's not that I'm threatening, and I don't think the board is threatening to pull their SE. But my concern was, I changed my vote when the second time came around based solely on the fact that they had assured us that they had security in place and that would not allow this type of thing to happen. And what I would like to, and if the board doesn't want it, that's fine, but I would very much like to sit down and talk to Paul and find out what have they done to improve the security there to make sure that these type of things don't happen again. I'm not threatening, I wouldn't be threatening to pull their special exception. That's not the point. But the point is, I think they should be accountable for what they say to us as a board, and then things like that happen. So from that standpoint, I'm not asking the board for anything. I would very much like to find out as to, number one, how did it happen? How did your security fail to allow this type of thing to happen? And especially for, they told us they had bed counts and bed checks and the doors were closed. And, you know, those guys were, and girls were basically monitored 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And so it was not the fact that, he never said that we had lapses in our security. And so I personally want to know what happened, number one, and number two, what have you done to correct the problem that evidently was there to allow four, not one, but four of these young people to escape and to steal a motorbike or scooter or whatever, four-wheeler, whatever it was. So that's where I'm coming from with ALA, and that was, I had here for my comment, want to know where we at in that process, and have we talked to them, and have we requested a meeting?
Mr. Akers, we met with Mr. Branning last week. He's in the process of basically answering those questions, and we actually have him, I think, tentatively on the agenda to come to the board at the June 10th meeting to address those questions.
That's fine. Thank you.
I will say that Abundant Life Academy is in my district. I had a couple of phone calls about this. I will just caution everybody to have Abundant Life come here and start testifying as to what happened. I believe the sheriff's office has actually pressed charges on the individuals that left. I think that we need to let due process take its course. I do think they need to explain, but I don't think a board meeting in public is the way to handle this. I think it's going to be detrimental to us and them to do that. I think that if we want an explanation, a meeting with Abundant Life, one-on-one or two-on-two may be the answer, more than bringing it to a board meeting to say, because I don't want to become a material witness in something because two kids or four kids escaped and we're now talking about it at a board meeting, and then we become information gatherers on a case that the sheriff has ongoing and is going to court. Those are my comments on that, and I would also like to echo Mr. Black's appreciation of the ceremony yesterday. It was really wonderful. It was great to hear a woman's perspective on the military and the history. It was a wonderful celebration, and I'd like to thank the unit for doing that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Seeley. And so we'll all understand. I think I was the one who brought up ALA as board comments, and I brought that up because this was the fourth escape there, whether you want to call them escapes or runaways or whatever. My only concern was that the sheriff's department is probably expending quite a bit of money in overtime to try to retrieve those students, especially the last one. They'd already gotten to King George. All I was concerned with is making sure the county was reimbursed by ALA for that. Now, there are all sorts of issues going on there, which will come to light soon, but I don't think I ever said pull their special exception. I don't believe Mr. Akers said pull their special exception. But, Mr. Black, there is no precedent when we start pulling special exceptions. I have voted to pull somebody's special exception here, and that's basically the rule. If you don't abide by the conditions of the special exception, the board not only should, but it must pull your special exception. So there is no precedent we're setting with them. That is the special exception process. So if anybody aside from them is not upholding the conditions of their special exception, it is our responsibility to pull their special exception, because they've made an arrangement with the county. ALA, you know, somebody's junkyard or whoever it is. And I didn't say pull their special exception. I wanted them to pay for whatever costs we had, which I asked Mr. Fincham to make sure was in their proffers or their conditions. So that's special exceptions. With your discussion of rural internet, what I said at the last meeting, and I thought I was clear, but obviously I wasn't, I said I'm starting to look at a new technology called TV Whitespace. And that technology allows us to use what were the over-air TV frequencies that are now being used for digital, but they're available and they could be used for internet in the future. I have identified a company that I'm trying to talk to see a presentation from this and maybe some more. So I know I wasn't clear because when I got home, I had at least two phone calls that said, when is the internet coming to the county? And I actually said I was looking at this technology, which may be a while out. So we're looking at the technology. We're trying to make that happen. So that's it. And my one board comment was, at our meeting with the school board last week or week before last, the school board chairman's meeting, I asked them to include targets for what the state calls SWAM businesses, small women and minorities, and put in a 10% target in their contract, so maybe that we could get, of the $25 million, we could get $2.5 million in local businesses in the county. So we're trying to do that. I expect Mr. Cully, you'll see some of their contracts soon, and we'll look for that. So that was it. That's it for board comments. Any other questions? Okay, we'll move on to presentations. Mr. Nelson, you're the first one with the VDOT report. Good to see you, sir.
Good evening, members of the board, county staff. So I'm here to provide you your quarterly update. I want to give you an update on some of the preliminary engineering projects that we've got. The Route 721 bridge replacement over Beverly Creek, the design is underway and we're waiting for to look at the funding to see when it will be likely advertised. The construction projects that we've got going on, you've got the Route 639 Ladysmith Road and intersection improvement project that's going on. That's scheduled to be complete in May 2015. The contractor is now on phase two and they actually may be finishing the work prior to May of 2015. Hopefully sometime this winter. The Route 633 bridge replacement over South River has actually been awarded, and the bridge was closed to traffic on April 4th. That is scheduled to be completed in April of 2015. The Route 654 bridge replacement over Reedy Creek is scheduled for August of 2014 completion. Now to go over some of the requests from the last board meeting. Mr. Black, you had requested us to address the striping and signal timing issues at Route 639. The signal detection was upgraded in April, and we also fixed the striping issues. There was also a request for litter removal on Route 639. That was completed, and we're going to pick it up again prior to our mowing this fall, this summer. There was also a request to clean the curb and gutter along Route 639. That was completed the week of May 19th. Mr. Seeley, there was a request to investigate a means of clearly identifying the limits of pavement at Route 207 in West Broadus. I provide you that sketch, and we're planning to update that striping plan on June 2nd. Mr. Akers, there was a request to provide a construction schedule update for Ladysmith Road. As I said, that project is slated to be completed in May of 2015. The contractor right now potentially may finish before the winter. Mr. Thomas, I wanted to give you an update on the striping at the Carmel Church Loop Road. We're planning to execute that work the week of June 2nd. And also, the Belmont Subdivision sidewalk work is scheduled for mid-July. That concludes my updates. Are there any requests from the board members?
Mr. Taylor? Yes, just a couple. Thank you again, Mr. Nelson, for being here. And this may be... I don't think they have finished, but they're doing something with the Macedonia Road and Stonewall Jackson. Mm-hmm. Macedonia Road comes to an end at Stonewall Jackson. And I think there must have been an accident there or something. And they used to have a sign, and there were also the bumps in the road that let you know you were coming to an end. I think it was like two sets. I think it's now like one set. I don't know if they're finished or not, but it's just really important because that's a very dangerous situation there, especially when people don't know the road. They aren't familiar with the road, and at night, and just all of a sudden it just ends. And there have been a number of accidents. Fortunately, I don't know of anybody actually getting seriously injured, but we kind of don't want to wait for that to happen. So I guess my question is, are they going to put all the strips back and all the signage that's been there all the time going to be replaced?
I'll check on that. It was either a resurfacing project that we did, but you indicated an accident that was there that may have taken something out?
Well, there was a car that kind of just went over in there.
Okay.
And they had a sign with reflectors with the arrows pointing.
in both directions.
Yeah, to let you know.
I think we're also working on another, some upgrade of signage at this location because we've had a couple of complaints about it. So I'll check into it and give you an update.
Thank you very much. And the other thing I had was, I had some phone calls concerning the turnaround at Burma Road. I don't know if everything has been completed with that or not, but there was some concern that maybe the turnaround would not accommodate some of the larger vehicles. I don't know that to be a fact because, you know, I have not actually talked to anybody from VDOT. But I know when we made that decision to privatize or to allow that part of the road to become privatized, there was the turnaround was supposed to be one that would
accommodate the traffic that utilizes the road.
Right.
Yeah.
If you could check on that, I would appreciate it.
Okay.
That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. Mr. Black, did you have anything?
I have a few things. First of all, I want to thank you for all the work that you've done. You've been great, I mean, as far as getting all the stuff done. I just want to go over, by the way, the curb and gutter near Ladysmith, the intersection of Route 1 and Ladysmith Road, it looks so much better than it did a couple weeks ago with all the sand and the weeds in there. I just had a couple questions. Along where the traffic light is there and right along, I guess, about 10 feet away from the curb, who is that your responsibility to mow, or is that who would mow that, like the grass? Once above the curb, it gets, because it's
if it's within the buffer strip, it's more than likely us, and we just haven't gotten around to mowing on our secondary roadways yet.
Okay, because you guys did a great job on the curb, but it's just like the grass is, you know, the grass is, and there's, you know, there's a piece of property right there that's, you know, up for sale and, you know, so forth. So it's just kind of one of the highlights of Ladysmith that we want to make sure looks nice for people going through there. And the site distance around Lake Landor, have you guys, and I haven't noticed, I did not notice, have you guys cut down that brush looking to the west from Lake Landor?
No, we cut down the trees.
You cut down the trees, but you said you had additionally marked some territory for more brush to be cut down.
Yeah, we're going to work with Lake Landor to try to get that, to get
that
taken down.
Okay, that's something you need to talk to Mr. Donakai about?
Yes.
All right. And the final thing, and I appreciate everything that you have done. I appreciate your email. You know, in the speed study you guys did, I'll be honest with you, I'm just really concerned because I make that turn as well. I'm just really concerned, and I talked to you just a little while ago. I mean, that speed limit going through there, I'm concerned someone's going to get killed at that intersection. I really am. I mean, and I understand you've done what you were supposed to do, but I mean, there's a concern there for someone turning left. There's a lot of industrial traffic coming from the west that someone's going to get cold clock coming, you know, obviously turning toward to go to Ladysmith and coming from the west.
Okay.
So that is a concern. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Underwood?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On Old Dawn Boulevard, there's a pallet store there where there's a lot of standing, anytime it rains, there's standing water on the road there. It's a pond on one side. And then once you cross 30 going toward the trash compactor, that whole road there, the water just stands when it rains. And there are culverts along the side, but I'm not sure if they're clogged or what needs to be done, but there's just standing water there when it rains.
Okay, I'll get our area superintendent to look at that.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Akers?
Mr. Nelson, you mentioned that the contractor is working on phase two.
Mm-hmm.
What does phase two include there?
He shifts the traffic right now, I believe. He's completed work on the southern side, so now he's working on the northern side. They're going to have to do some utility work, extend some pipes across Route 639, and, of course, work on the turn lane that's going to be there.
The turn lanes are going to begin about Rice Chapel Church, I think. How far will it go up?
I can't recall from off the top of my head how far it's going to come up.
My recollection is your right turn or decel lane, there'll be one into Wright's Chapel. It will continue down to the business park and ultimately end up at the entrance into the shopping center. There'll also be the center left turn lane that will run approximately the same distance to allow left turns going eastbound into the shopping center, the business park, and Wright's Chapel as well. So you'll have your through lanes will truly become through lanes and will not be used for turn movements in either direction.
Are they going to move the signal poles? I see that there's a lot of wires and what have you. Are they going to move the signal poles?
They're going to have to move the signal poles throughout there.
But we're not. We still don't have enough space in order to have a northbound turn lane?
I don't believe so. Not in part of this project.
Well, he would know if they had enough space.
That's correct, Mr. Akers. We would have to demolish the convenience store at the corner, at the northeast corner of Route 1 and 639 for that turn lane.
Couple of others. On the new construction, as you're going east on mm-hmm. 639, you're going straight, and then all of a sudden there's a little dog, well, it's not even as bad as the dog leg, but a little dog leg that goes out. Why couldn't we have kept that straight there?
You're talking about the dog leg right now?
Yeah, it's on the new construction.
Yeah, well, that's a part of their configuration for them to actually widen it out. It's not going to have a dog leg in it once the project is complete. That's the sequencing of construction in order to have enough room to work through there.
Oh, okay. Because the way I was visioning it, it was just...
Yeah, it won't have that jut in it once we're complete.
The ditch on the south side of 639 near McDonald's.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
Is anything being done about that? Because, I mean, water stands and it really rains hard. The water comes over the roadway there, especially since the road has been...
I've worked with our land use engineer to try to get that problem rectified, and I'll have to get an update on him where we stand on that.
Because we really need to do something with that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Nelson.
Mm-hmm.
Ms. Steele?
Again, Mr. Nelson, thank you for the striping on that turnoff of 207. It'll make a huge difference, and if you can send me that, I'll try to get it to the paper so they can at least show folks what that really means, because the diagram that I had originally looks great.
Okay.
I have two things. Actually, one's not in my district. One is the railroad tracks at 605 Page Road. Can we see what if there's any schedule from the railroad on actually fixing those? Because they're really getting rough.
Okay.
We're back into baseball season, and folks cut across from the Ladysmith side across there, and it's an interesting traverse when you hit those. And if you don't know they're there,
especially at high speed,
if you're not slowing down, you're in trouble.
I can check with the railroad company for that.
Take a look. I mean, it's just really getting bad, and folks have really noticed it here lately. I went to visit MC Dean, and they're actually located off of Coleman Town Road. Isn't that Coleman Town?
Coleman Mill Road.
Sorry about that. Thank you, Mr. Akers. And they are the fifth largest electrical contractor in the United States. I don't know if you knew that or not, but they are building components that actually get shipped to large construction sites. But their main way in and out with trucks is on Dry Bridge Road.
Mm-hmm.
And the turn on a dry bridge is sort of okay, but the S-curve in Dry Bridge, the sight line problems, and you can see where the trucks are being run off the road when they're meeting other traffic. Is there any way to take a look at that and make a sight line through some of those trees, through that S-curve, and actually trim back the trees from the road?
We can trim back what's within our right-of-way.
Right.
Yeah, we can trim back within our right-of-way.
I guess what I'd like to see is there a way we could have the folks from MC Dean and somebody from your office and Mr. Thomas and or myself meet you folks out there and take a look at this?
Yeah, sure.
Because they'd like to add additional manufacturing space, but their big limitation is actually shipping.
Access.
So not the best of location, but it's where they're at, and they've got I don't know if you've seen it, it's a huge facility.
Okay.
So I'll get Mr. Cully, the manager's card, and maybe we can coordinate with them to have a meeting set up, if that's okay, Mr. Thomas.
We've taken care of that part.
Well, thank you. But again, thank you for the 207, and thanks for all the work you do for us.
No problem.
Mr. Nelson, mine is more general. Mr. Wilson is working with quite a few new businesses and prospects, none of which will he let me announce or talk about, but a few depend upon the relationship with VDOT and the timeliness of their approvals.
Okay.
So when we have something that the prospect needs to have approved quickly, may I just come to you directly and say, we need you to cut through the red tape and get this approved?
I have no problem with that.
Okay. And you are the one that can say yes, right?
I am the one that knows all the moving parts.
Okay. Well, no, my question was, you are the one that can say
yes. I am the one that knows all the moving parts.
We appear to be playing tag.
And you're it.
But you know the person that can say yes.
Generally speaking.
Okay, okay. That's really, we have a couple in the works right now. One Mr. Wilson just mentioned today.
Okay.
And they have it's a very large, very good thing. But we need to make sure we get their site plan work done as quickly as possible. So if you don't mind, I will probably be calling you or having somebody call you on my behalf to say, please help us.
Okay.
Because if you help us, we might have some money for matching road funds.
That's always nice.
Okay.
Can you save a post office?
What's that?
Can you save a post office?
Yeah.
Only if there's a road going through it. So thank you, Mr. Nelson. I think that's it. We do appreciate your time and your being here. So.
All right.
And you did a great job again.
Okay,
next we have the Caroline County Transit Corridor and Facilities Alternative Analysis. Mr. White. Oh, Mr. Wilson's going to start for Mr. White.
Yes, sir, if I may. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We do have Mr. White of Kimberly Horn. He's our consultant for this project. This is the Corridor and Facilities Alternatives Analysis Study that he'll be presenting for you this evening. This was a Federal Transit Administration grant of $490,000 secured by economic development to do this study. The match was by the Thompsons. There is no county money in this project, so we're very pleased with that. Mr. White's going to present a number of alternatives this evening. I'm not going to duplicate his presentation. I would only say at this particular juncture that we have as a placeholder in the document 4C as a selected alternative that is preferred by the county. That's the city-to-city commuter rail, and that's what we've been working on for quite some time. And I also would stress that making a selection for any locally preferred alternative does not obligate the county in any way to spend any money on this project. So with no further ado, I'll have Mr. White make his presentation.
Yes, sir, I do. Thank you. FNF8. The presentation. Try the secondary. It's not transmitting now. Yep. No, I got a handout, too.
Why don't you do your handout?
All right. Sounds good.
Does it?
Yeah.
All right, we're going to move from
To restart. Yeah. Do what? Restart. All right. Mr. Partner.
Hand those out.
I prepared, planned ahead, brought a copy. Just in case. There we go. Projector doesn't see it because the iPad's not firing up yet. Ready? All right. I just wanted to take a second to outbrief the board on the balloon event that happened a couple weeks ago. Before we start, I think it's important that we remember the three people that were in the balloon that lost their lives: Daniel Kirk, Jenny Doyle, and Natalie Lewis. And it's with them in mind that we talk about this event to try to learn from it. If you go to the second page, a couple things we want to talk about in the pre-event planning that I'm not sure the board was aware of. I know you got briefings from Mr. Culley, but this balloon event was the first time we used the new proffers. I know you haven't adopted those for Meadow Event or in CF&E, but we used those as a guide for this event. And we sat down with the promoter of the event, the balloonist in the event, and made sure that we had a solid emergency management plan before the event started. We knew all the risks before that event started, and we had staff down there because of some of those risks. And I was one of those that day. The Sheriff's Office, the Fire Department, VSP, conferenced with the Balloon Pilots Association beforehand, so we could understand the risk of the propane and all of the risks associated with landing. And there were some law enforcement risks as well that we knew we had to be prepared for, as well as the eventual disaster that could occur. There were a few disasters with ballooning that we had planned for. After that initial meeting, we took our first responders, our law enforcement partners, both VSP and the Sheriff's Office, down to Meadow Event Park for an in-service on the balloon. We had firefighters from Caroline, firefighters from Hanover. The Sheriff's Office had several people down there to put hands on the balloon and talk about the event directly to the balloonists and directly on a balloon. So we understood some of the risks we were going to experience on landing from both fire response and rescue, as well as the law enforcement side, before the event ever took place. And it's really because of those proffers. Otherwise, we really wouldn't have known what was going down at that day, and we really wouldn't have a say in some of the planning elements and assure those things were done. The other thing for us with the Sheriff's Department, 911 Center, we sent a letter to all of the surrounding jurisdictions that there was going to be a balloon event. One of the things we learned is most people will call in a balloon disaster on a regular landing. A lot of times they skim the trees when they come in. A lot of times people see them drop behind the horizon or drop behind a tree and think they're going to crash. So we sent a letter to all of the surrounding jurisdictions, their public safety answering points, and said, if you get any balloon calls coming in your 911 center, we want to filter it down to the command post at Meadow Event Park so we can call the pilot and try to deal with that issue and not send responses on the road. We had to cover the surrounding jurisdictions because that day we didn't know which way the wind was going to blow. So it could have blown very differently than it did on that day. Because of the proffers, again, we had a joint emergency operations center. The Sheriff's Department had personnel right down there at that center, as did Fire Rescue, as did Virginia State Police, as did Meadow Event. I plugged it in. As we go to the next page, the actual event. Friday, May 9th, about 18:30 hours. Hey, Joey, can you get that screen back? We had a small number of balloons that were going to get ready to lift off. Not all of them were going to go because they were going to do a night glow. Some of them didn't feel they could get their balloon off the field and come back in time for the night glow. And that's when they light up at night right there and stay on the ground. All the balloons were going to take a short flight. It wasn't going to be a long flight in duration. Password one with capital P.
Is your caps on?
It could be.
Go ahead.
All right, I'll keep going. How's that? All right. As you see on this map here, the first one, kind of hard to see with the pins. The first pin is the launch site at the bottom. Still working. And then you can see where the second pin is the strike with the power lines, where the balloon hit the power line. Keep that mind, that line in mind, because we're going to talk about some of the trajectory of the balloon on the second page. The balloon itself makes a contact with the power lines about 3.7 miles into its flight. What we know from the reports originally, there we go. What we know from the reports originally is a propane line is ruptured, and that is liquid propane, not gas. Okay, so it's coming out of the tank, and it's expanding very rapidly, about 270 times its volume. And yep. Okay. Because of that fire, the balloon rises uncontrolled. It is rapidly rising into the air, which makes a difference on its trajectory. If you can see this yellow line, this is the path, the 3.7 miles it traveled. After it hit the power line, you notice this white line, and that is the projected arc of the balloon after it made its strike. It is going more toward the eastern side, and that is because the balloon is going up in elevation. The winds at the higher elevation are different than the lower winds down closer to the earth.
Chief, what was the altitude of the balloon at the strike of the power line? Was that
about 30 feet?
30 feet?
Yep.
But at the instant it struck the power line, it was rising uncontrollably.
As soon as that propane line broke and a fire ensued, it was uncontrollably rising because of that massive amount of heat that coming off that liquid propane could not be vented enough through the top. We've seen some video of the pilot trying to vent the top of the balloon, but again, that volume of fire cannot be vented. So it's going to rise up, and it's going to continue to rise as long as it has fire.
And survivability at 35 feet is minimal. Any height above that is just not going to happen.
Probability goes down.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. All right. The yellow zone, after we established our command post, the yellow zone was our primary search area. All right. If we had not had the balloon pilots with us, if we had not established that relationship in the front end, I brought the balloon pilot guy, they call the balloon meister, he's in charge of all the balloonists, I brought him with us. Okay. They developed the path, they looked at the winds, they looked at the trajectory, and they said the path of the balloon will be along this white line going more toward the north into the east. But in our initial operations, our initial search zone was that yellow area, about 1,300 acres of extremely dense wooded area. And because of that, very early, we called in Henrico County Police Department, their air support, Virginia State Police air support. And we knew the only way to get quick and hasty searches done was by that air support. And they did find things for us to go in. We found the first victim in that manner. Saturday and Sunday, we were able to narrow our search down based on information that we found from searching in the woods to that red zone, and that was our primary target zone. And in the end of the day, we found all of the pieces for recovery in that red zone. Okay? But initially, a very large search area, a very daunting task for the first responders to get there. I think it's important for the board to know the breadth of the people that were there. Virginia State Police had a very strong presence, but you look at all the other agencies that came apart to make this thing happen. The event happened around 8 o'clock, 8 p.m. on a Friday. By 6 in the morning, we had the majority of these people at Caroline Pines, ready to go, getting debriefed by Major Mosier to go out in the field and begin a coordinated search effort. So a lot of people were dropped in Caroline County very quickly. The sheriff and I have just completed thank you letters to all of these agencies. The sheriff himself will reach out to Virginia State Police because they did put a tremendous amount of resource into the county to make this search effective, as well as Henrico County Police Aviation Division. Without their aircraft covering that zone, we would have not found the spot fire, which led us to the first person, which really began our theories to work from that person back toward the strike zone. So, any questions about any of those agencies? Lastly, I just want to focus on a couple things for the board. Every 4 years, the board approves the Caroline County Emergency Operations Plan. It is that plan we used for this event. That plan identified who was going to be in charge, and that became very important for us. We had a lot of different organizations there. For the first 10 hours, the fire department was in charge. For the remaining of the event, the sheriff's office was in charge. So we had a national event, but it was truly managed locally by our office and the sheriff's department and all the other people that came in. But again, it was stayed local as a management tool. The incident commanders switched back and forth between our office and the sheriff and the captain. And that is a little different. That's identified in the board's plan.
You said you were in charge for the first 10 hours.
That's correct.
Is that because it was a rescue operation and then it became a recovery operation and the sheriff was in charge?
That's correct. And the recovery really was a search and rescue at that point, or search and recovery.
Search and recovery, right.
The fire department, we don't do search.
Right.
That falls under the sheriff. Right. But there was an accident. We will go in there for the rescue, which is that first 10-hour period.
Right.
Then our focus changed a little
okay.
bit. Okay. Certainly.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure that was clear.
Yep. The importance of the new proffers, without those proffers, we would not have established the relationships, had the planning that we did, had the presence down there at Meadow Event. So I can't say enough for those. That is truly key. If I hadn't met the Balloonmeister or I met him that day, I would not have brought him to the scene. I knew he was going to be an asset for me. I knew he was going to be able to tell me all the balloons were down, how many people were in this balloon, what the cell phone numbers of those people in those balloons were, which were later used by the different offices to help locate the folks. The other piece that both the sheriff and I have talked to this board about is our radio system. This is a key event in the county, which our radio system was inadequate. We were down to cell phones. Where we found the first victim, we were down to cell phone communications because our system would not go out. We made some decisions to use Caroline Pines as a command post, and that decision was solely based on Caroline County maintaining some control over its assets and units in the field, because if we had gone to Meadow Event Park, which has a suitable place for a command post, we would have lost all communications, both portable and mobile. Our system today is just not adequate in that part of the county. So I want to thank the board for voting for the new system. It'll personally give us communication in that area, give us interoperability on some of the national frequencies, that we would be able to communicate with Henrico as well as the state police without having to do a patch. We can do that right from our portables. So when we talk about the radio system and the board's commitment to funding that, here's a prime example where that would have been ideal for us to have that level of communication in place. And lastly, the need for specialized response equipment. We had to go out as a fire department and borrow another fire department's four-wheel drive Gator to be able to remove some of the victims from the woods and get some of our people into the woods. So before you tonight, on the consent agenda, you have some surplus. We would like to try to use some of those surplus to buy a specialized piece so that we can use it for both fire and EMS in the densely wooded areas of our county, because we have a lot of them. We really do. And this is just one event. As we do more at Meadow Event Park, both the Sheriff's Office and us, having a vehicle we can travel around to do fire inspections is invaluable for us. I would like the Sheriff to say something about today's events for the board.
Good evening. I did talk with each of you a little bit earlier, but wanted to also let the press know, too, that the rest of the balloon has been located. They were by Caroline residents. They wish to remain anonymous. As a matter of fact, they came by my house last night to tell me about it. We went out this morning, Major Moser, Captain Lambert, and the two other individuals, and we did locate it. We've been in touch with NTSB. And we have recovered that item for them. The thing that I will let the press know, and y'all are getting it first from anyone else, it was found in the Mattapani River. And the best location I'm going to give you now, you can say between Milford and 301. So reports of everything being east of 301 turned out to not happen. So just to let you all know, we do have that. We're still working on it. Again, I thank everyone that was involved with it and wanted to give you that heads up. Of course, my condolences goes to the three victims and their families also.
Any questions?
Any questions? No questions? Chief, you're gonna assure us that the new radio system is going to work in this area?
Without a doubt, because of the Doswell Tower, most definitely.
Okay.
Most definitely.
I think Motorola will, too, so we should be.
Okay. All right. No other questions? All right. Thank you, Chief.
Thank
Sheriff.
You.
Mr. White, you want to try again?
Before you do that, can I go back, or you want me to hold my comments for the ALA? I wanted to bring that up since y'all were talking about that just earlier.
Yeah, why don't you hold those comments, and we'll talk to ALA and probably let the county administrator talk to you about it.
That'll be fine.
Thank you. Mr. White?
Pardon me 1 minute here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, for allowing us a few minutes to talk about this important study we've been doing with economic development and, frankly, with some of your regional partners as well. I'm going to give you a brief status update on this transit corridor study we're doing. Feel free, of course, to interrupt me as you have any questions. But I'm going to focus on sort of where we've been, why we're doing this, and what we've done to date, so to bring you up to speed on where we are. The recommendations for an alternative to carry forward, and then the next steps for this process, frankly, beyond the scale of the study we're doing. So I'll just start with the study area for the project extends throughout the county along both I-95 and the CSX mainline corridor, and then it also reaches out to Washington, D.C. and Richmond. And the reason for that really is why we're doing this. And the reason that we're doing this is because, as you know well, living where you do, that going north, going south, depending on the time of day, can be incredibly difficult, whether you're traveling into the county for work or to visit or out of the county as a resident or a worker. I-95 has simply become unreliable in terms of being able to predict travel time on it because of the congestion. And meanwhile, we have an increasing number of both freight trains as well as passenger trains traveling on the rail corridor. So that corridor is increasingly busy as well. So the charge for this project was to look at opportunities to enhance mobility for residents, workers in Caroline County, looking at both the I-95 and the CSX mainline corridors. The process we were involved in is what's formally referred to by the Federal Transit Administration as an alternatives analysis. And you can really think of that as a detailed study of different options and their potential feasibility in serving that purpose that you saw in the previous slide. And it's a very straightforward process. It looks at the conditions today, which informs the need for the project. We develop alternatives in response to those needs, And then we hope to arrive at a preferred alternative that the sponsor, in this case being the county, could work with its partners to advance in some way to making mobility improvements or making improvements. We're at the point in the process right now where we have a recommendation in front of you, and that's mostly what I'd like to talk about today. But I'll walk you through some of the progress to date. We've been coordinating with your MPO partner in FAMPO. We've been working closely with county staff, with local, as well as with local landowners. We've also worked with the State Department of Rail and Public Transportation, and we've spent some time working with the Federal Transit Administration to keep them appraised to our progress. The beginning of the study, we collected a whole bunch of data from different studies the county has done, the region has done, and the state has done to form a basis for what we were going to do. We did go out in the field because this particular study looked at or needed to look at different potential transportation facility locations. We looked at a number of different locations, so we did a field review as well. We communicated all of this front-end information to our state and federal partners in what's called an initiation package to get their buy-in on what we were going to study. After that, we started to develop alternatives. Lots of different ideas for transit alternatives were generated, centered around that purpose and need that formed the basis for the study. We went through two rounds of screening. The first round of screening, think of that as we're trying to remove ideas that just won't work for this particular corridor. Round two, we were fine-tuning those ideas to the one that will work the best to meet our project purpose and need. Okay. So in our first tier of screening, we looked at all of these different potential transit mode options. And what came out of it was that the most effective way to serve this project's purpose and need would be accommodated through things like express bus and commuter bus, coach services that you see today that operate in the I-95 corridor serving particular origins and then employment destinations in DC and Richmond. Bus rapid transit, which think of that as everything that rail transit is without rails. Good stations, good quality service, quick service, but on a bus. Commuter rail, VRE is the best example we have in Virginia right now. And then inner city passenger rail. So those services that are passenger rail services operated right now by Amtrak that operate between cities throughout the East Coast but are shorter distance, more work purpose travel. All of those ones on the bottom really didn't fit the purpose and need for what we were looking at, so we eliminated them. We looked at a number of different facility locations where this service would be centered in the future. You can see on this map it was Carmel Church, Ladysmith, Bowling Green, and then a station in the location of Route 606, actually I think quite close to the Stonewall Jackson Shrine. We looked at that station location because of its near proximity to the proposed and currently planned extension of VRE to Crossroads, knowing that we would, if we were going to look at a commuter rail extension in particular, we needed to make it a manageable length in at least its first phase. And of course, we needed to locate it along the rail line. Through extensive study and evaluation, what we determined, including comparison with the county's plans for the future, we determined that the most effective location for a future transit facility was going to be in the vicinity of Carmel Church. It has great rail access. It has very good access to I-95. It's in an area where the county has planned growth in the future, and there are certainly designs on growth there. The county's looking to attract economic activity to that zone. For all of those reasons, and some others as well, that was the location that seemed, as far as our study was concerned, to be the most effective location to make a transit investment in the future. So I'm going to walk through a couple of the alternatives. This first one you'll see is from Ladysmith. Throughout the process, we did maintain some alternatives that weren't at the preferred location, mostly on a comparative basis. So alternative 2D looked at commuter bus service originating to and from Ladysmith, traveling both north and south in the I-95 corridor. Alternative 4C looked at intercity passenger rail service. So basically putting a station onto the CSX line, not unlike what Ashland has. Hopefully we analyzed it as a more permanent station with a regular stop schedule. So actually, let me relate it more to the Fredericksburg station. So that, and it would, you'd have service traveling north and south on that CSX line using Amtrak service. Alternative 6C, alternative 6 was a two-phase alternative. In the near term, it would, we would incept a commuter bus service prior to rail service. We're sort of thinking ahead, thinking it, there could be a need for the beginning of a service in the corridor sooner than we could get passenger rail service started there. And so we look, actually analyzed what would be involved in creating a commuter bus service that would eventually transition in time to a passenger rail service. We evaluated these alternatives in a very detailed way using a number of different screening criteria. And when we scored it out, 6C actually had the highest rating, we think, because of the stepped implementation. 4C, which is the intercity passenger rail service, scored very, very well. And each of those scored better than any of the other alternatives we studied. What I would say about this is any of those ones in blue on the left would be good locally preferred policy alternatives because of their relative effectiveness. So just a quick recap, alternative 2D is commuter bus service relying on the existing roadway network. 4C is passenger rail service using the CSX mainline, intercepting Amtrak services with a new station at Carmel Church. And then 6C is that combination of both 2D and 4C that in the short term would look like 2D and in the long term would look like 4C. So we just wanted to give you a couple of visuals of what a station might look like. So what you can see in this graphic there at the bottom, you can actually see where there would be a commuter parking lot associated with this, at least in the short term, a couple of bus bays, some nice station facilities to provide a place where people get a feel that this is where the service would operate to and from. There would be some technology associated with the station to tell people where the services are going, when they arrive, and all of that. We would design this over time to fit within the context of the larger development plan for Carmel Church, so it's seamless. In the short term, it would start out as a surface lot. In the future, it may be able to transition to either a public space and then get the have the parking relocated into a garage, or on the site, perhaps that could transition into a parking structure. As rail comes online, the rail station would be in a tangent section of the CSX mainline, which is consistent with, I believe, the development plans that have been shown to date, which is where the freight rail operator would want it. And it's also where the state, DRPT, has studied the station location in the past. You would have a very carefully coordinated bus and rail interface, as well as a pedestrian connector bridge across the rail. Of course, we can't have people walking across an active passenger and freight rail line. So in the long term, you can see both in this graphic, the interface between the passenger station, rail station, as well as the bus services. And I should say, I've been talking in terms of commuter services thus far. As the county changes over time and your local transit service perhaps grows or the need grows, this facility also could accommodate that service as well. So where we are in the process is we're getting ready to put together the final documents that will allow county staff and others to continue to have conversations with state and federal partners as to how to potentially bring a different transit and passenger rail service to the county. And really what we need this evening is to have a discussion and I hope some feedback from you all as to what you see as the right policy approach for the county to have for the alternative to enhance transit services for the county. And that's all I have. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present.
All right, thank you, Mr. White. Mr. Wilson, we appreciate the presentation and your moving forward. Normally, when we take a presentation like this, we're not going to make a decision right away on the presentation. But we will, if you'll provide that PowerPoint to us, we will put it on our consent agenda for our next meeting.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, we did the chief appointments, no BZA, EMS, Mr. Taylor, Port Royal District.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would like to see Mr. Wick to return to the Emergency Services Commission representing the Port Royal District. I will make that into a motion.
Thank you.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Social Services, Mr. Underwood.
Mr. Chairman, I'm making a motion that we reappoint Ms. Sherry James to the Social Services Board as the Arena Church District Representative.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Underwood, second by Mr. Akers. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. That motion carries. Middle Peninsula Juvenile Detention Center, of course, we're going to reappoint Mr. Parton. Would somebody like to make that motion?
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion we reappoint Mr. Alan Parton to be Middle Peninsula Juvenile Detention Commissioner.
Second?
Second.
Okay. Mr. Seeley and Mr. Akers, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
That motion carries unanimously. Okay, consent agenda. Anything we'd like to pull from the consent agenda?
We're just looking at the website. Proposals, correct.
And take a look at RFP and
right.
See what's out there.
Okay.
Yeah, we're not making a decision of buying anything. We're just saying we want to put it out to bid now.
Okay. I make a motion we approve the consent agenda as proposed.
Second.
All right. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Motion carries unanimously. And then can we do number 8, which really won't be any big deal?
Oh, that's true.
What was Mr. Cohen? And you did the review of Ben. Okay. Okay. We basically got, we're going to move to agenda item 8 before we take our break, just because it should be fairly quick. We've got the memorandum of understanding with the school board regarding the clerk of the court. There was, clerk of the works, clerk of the court. Sorry, Mr. Campbell. But anyhow, as the board had said before, we wanted to have someone from inspections as part of the project, and now our someone from inspections will actually be the clerk of the court. So it,
clerk of the works.
Okay, brain cramp. Clerk of the works, thank you. So any discussion, questions? Huh? That's probably because I got hit in the head earlier. I'm going to recover from that. Any questions?
Mr. Chairman, I do have a comment about this. I understand the reason for suggesting this, but I think so we also need to understand that what we're basically doing is saying to the school board, we're allowing you to put the monkey from their back onto our back if anything goes wrong, because you know as well as I do, having a county official, and he certainly is an official of building, being a building official or a building inspector, as the clerk of the works for these projects, it's going to come back to look at the county, to the board, as to, you put your guy here, something's wrong, don't come to me, you go to the Board of Supervisors, because they put their person here as clerk of the works. I just want to make sure we understand that, that that's what's going to happen to us, and I'm just not sure that's the best decision to go with those that route. But if that's the majority of the board wants, I'm going to go along with it as well. But I just want to raise caution here that I think that we could be developing an adversarial situation here that maybe it doesn't need to be.
I think your comments are justified to some degree. I think we were going to, in your words, have the monkey on our back regardless.
And possibly.
And if I'm going to have it on my back, I'm going to have somebody I know that can get it off, at least as quick as possible.
But I understand. I understand that.
I don't think the citizens of Carolina are going to look at just the school board if something goes wrong. I think they're going to look at all of us. And we've all said we're in this together. We're trying to help them make a good project. It is their responsibility.
I don't know that anybody's looked at us on the floors at the elementary school. And that's certainly been a problem. And still is a problem. And so I don't know that anybody, I've not had any calls, maybe other board members have, but I've not had any calls from anyone saying, why did you let that happen over there? in the Bowling Green Elementary addition with the floors. But again, I have concern.
Well, we said during our work session we're going to move forward, so.
I've expressed it, and I'm fine.
Any other questions, Mr. Taylor?
I guess the only thing that I would say is that we just have to be very careful that we're not perceived as holding the school to a different standard than we are other departments in the county. Certainly, and if I may use the sheriff, for example, he spends money. He buys cars. We don't go down to the dealership with him to make sure that he gets the car that we want. Social services and other departments, recreation. I know they don't spend to the magnitude, but I guess my thing is the citizens of Carlisle County voted overwhelmingly to do this. And I disagree. I don't think it's on us. I think they're elected just like we're elected. They are held to the same accountability, to the same people that we are elected to and held to. So if the board wants to do it, I will support what the board wants to do because we need to work together. But I just feel like the members of the school board are elected to run the school system, and it is their job to make sure that this project works and is done right. And I have enough work to do. I'm not looking to do somebody else's job.
So you want to... Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to make a comment. Was this not the school board actually... Wasn't this a negotiation between us and the school board that the school board was actually in agreement with, right? I mean, the school board actually was wanting this, correct?
Right. We offered it to them, and they said yes.
And they've got at least four votes there that say, well, we think that there's at least four votes saying that this is something that they want. So I guess I'm kind of baffled as to if it's their decision that that's what they want to enter in with the county, and they feel like it's saving them money and it's beneficial to both of us. I guess I'm kind of confused what we're arguing about, because if the majority of two boards are in agreement that this needs to happen, I mean, that's what they want. So they can't come back on us and say it's not what we want. We're not forcing them. They have to agree to this. And I mean, if their board says yes, then I don't see a counter argument to this. Thank you.
And again, and just one last comment. It's not my understanding that that was the case, and maybe I've been misinformed. And if that be the case, then that's fine. But I haven't seen anything from the school board requesting us to do that. Maybe there is such a document that I have not seen, but to date, I have not seen that.
Mr. Chairman, I think when we met with the school board, I don't think they had a quorum there at the time. I think they were short a person, but we were there in full force. And I do think members who were there agreed that it was a good thing to have a county person there. I would say that, you know, I've heard the word micromanage. I don't think we're trying to micromanage. I just like to get the best possible work done. And I know that our inspector has an eye for those types of things. He's very diligent and been doing it for a long time. With that said, I just think a second set of eyes on the project would help, and they basically agreed to that. So I don't see any harm.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not arguing about the situation at all. All I'm saying is the fact that it's my understanding we're putting a building inspector and not the building official. But the building inspector.
That's correct. They're going to pick one of the two building inspectors to use.
And the building official certainly goes over the building inspector. Another one of the building inspectors certainly inspects every phase of the construction when it comes to the foundation and all of those other things. And again, I'm not saying it's a bad idea. All I'm saying is the fact that I think the board is putting itself in a position whereas...
I understand you and Mr. Taylor have actually pointed out the downsides to this project, and there are always downsides to everything. I think what we're trying to do is to help. Not only when the sheriff Mr. Taylor mentions the sheriff buying cars, let's say the sheriff didn't buy the radio system, we bought the radio system. You know, we're trying to make sure the radio system works. I don't think we ever will give the sheriff $25 million to do anything, you know. But we just gave the school system $25 million. And as I read you in the back, some of the emails I've received about people paying their tax bill, they want to make sure that we deliver the best project. Now, I understand the school's core competency is education, not building. You know, they hire teachers. They hire administrators. You were one. You don't know anything about building except your own house. You don't know, but you know about teaching. They have thousands of people over there that know about teaching, not building. We're just trying to help them. You know, we're not micromanaging. We're not trying to do anything. We're just trying to put the best people in the right places to help us all get a good project. Because, quite honestly, I'm not happy when I pay my tax bill. So it better be used well. And that's what we're trying to do, is ensure it's done well. You know, it's part of a step we're going to do. We're going to try to do more maintenance with them. Because, again, their core competency is education. You know, Mr. Underwood does it, too. You don't really know anything about construction, building construction and things like that. You could care less. So why don't we help them? That's all we're saying. Okay?
But, and as I said, I go with the majority of the board.
Okay, well, is there a motion?
Mr. Thomas, since I was involved in both the two-on-two discussions with the school board, I think we've done a thorough job with their chairman and vice chairman and the superintendent. I feel confident that we're moving in a good, positive direction, and I'll make a motion to approve the Memorandum of Understanding with Caroline Public Schools for the Clerk of the Works for the school construction projects.
Second.
All right, motion made by Mr. Seeley, seconded by Mr. Black. We've had enough discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Motion carries unanimously. Mr. Cully, you'll present everything over to the school board, and I guess they'll meet next week. Oh, I mean tomorrow, that's right, because they're having a special meeting. Okay, we're going to take a 15-minute break at 7:20, according to that clock back there. We should be back at 7:35 for citizens' comments and public hearing. So thank you. All right, we will reconvene. We are at the public comment section of our agenda. At this point in time, anyone who would like to speak about any issue within the county may do so. We ask only that you, if you are going to speak on the public hearings, you wait until those public hearings come up before you speak on those. So at this point in time, we will ask anyone who would like to speak as part of citizens' comments to do so, and you will have 3 minutes. So is there anyone who would like to speak? Reverend Klingscales, good to see you, sir.
Good to see you, Mr. Chairman, other members of the board. Don't have any comments, just want to bring to the board a countywide revival that is being planned June 21st, the Meadow Farms Event Park down in Dodswell, Virginia. Just want to put a pin right there and kind of go back to October 15th of 2013 when Thomas Wendell Wheeler passed away in the gym at the high school. 6 days later, Sierra Lynn Moore took her own life in her home. The faith community rallied behind the families to comfort them. We joined hands and around the high school, and we held vigils for those individuals, and rightfully so. But the faith community came together during those tragic moments, and it was the leaders of the local churches here that began a conversation as, why do we only come together in tragedy? Why can we only agree and work together in emergency? And so we began to have conversations about a time where we could come together in a more relaxed atmosphere and just celebrate our faith belief together. And thus, community revival, which our theme is reviving hope, not only here in the county, but we're also will be raising money for local pastors that will be traveling over to Kenya this summer for a fact-finding missions trip to support a lot of the orphans that are there. But I wanted to bring to the board the attention to invite you to come out on Saturday, June 21st, 4 o'clock for a concert revival at the Meadow Farms Event Park that will culminate a three-day revival. But we will conclude at the Meadow Farms Event Park, and we invite you to come out and share in that experience with us, where the whole community will come together for a great evening of fellowship. Did I go over my time?
No.
Okay, good.
You have 20 seconds left if you want
it. Okay. Any questions?
No, we don't do good. You said it was the 21st at 1 o'clock?
At 4 o'clock. I will send you the flyers for the board so that you could have those and be able to disseminate those as you need.
Thank you, Reverend King Scales. This is not the Gospel Fest. It's something different, right?
Or is it is something different.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who would like to speak as part of citizens' comments or public comments? Anyone else? Anyone else would like to speak as part of public comments? Hearing none, public comments are declared closed. We will now move to our public hearings. We have a few today. Our first one is the VDOT fiscal year 2015 to 2020 six-year improvement plan. Sean, are you want to make a presentation beforehand? Or is that Mr. Fincham? Mr. Fincham?
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Mr. Shaw Nelson is here, the residency administrator for our area, to present the six-year secondary roads plan for Caroline County. As the board is aware, we update the six-year plan every year. Mr. Nelson's office has provided the proposed six-year plan based upon the funds available, both state and federal sources, as well as projects that are already in process or planned for completion in the six-year plan. You have an extra page that was handed out prior to the meeting, which reflects unpaved road funds, which previously were not included with the six-year plan provided to the board on Friday. And with that, I'll turn it over to Mr. Nelson.
Mr. Nelson?
Good evening again. I just wanted to say that the Code of Virginia requires the County Board of Supervisors and Department to formulate the six-year secondary improvement plan and a priority list for the secondary improvement budget. We have provided the proposed plan and budget for your consideration regarding this matter. Today's public hearing is being conducted for the 2015 through 2020 plan and the 2015 fiscal year. Please keep in mind that the plan is only for improvements and new construction. It does not include any maintenance work, such as potholes, pulling ditches, snow removal, or repairing roads. In preparation of updating the proposed six-year plan, we met with the county and staff to discuss the current plan and to seek guidance on any changes that may have been determined necessary by your county since the approval of the current plan. The proposed six-year plan has the following that has been recommended. There are two projects that are currently ongoing: Route 639 Ladysmith Road Intersection Reconstruction Project, Route 633 Bull Church Road Bridge Replacement over South River, Route 760 Sorrell Lane, which will be done as a rural rustic road similar to what we did on Colemantown Road, Faulkner, and OCC, and Route 629 Menarche Road, which will also be done similar to the way we've done Colemantown Road, Faulkner, and OCC. The funding amounts are estimated allocations, and if there are no questions from the board, I would recommend we approve this.
Thank you. We're going to have to kind of go through the process of having a public hearing first, though.
Okay.
Any questions for Mr. Nelson or Mr. Fincham at this time? None. Thank you, Mr. Nelson. If you'll have a seat, I'm sure there are thousands of people who want to speak on this. So I will declare the public hearing for the six-year road improvement plan to be open. Is there anyone who would like to speak regarding this matter? Is there anyone who would like to speak regarding this matter? Is there anyone who would like to speak regarding this matter? Hearing none, the public hearing is declared closed. Mr. Nelson, if you'd like to come back, and I'll ask again if there are any questions. I don't imagine there are any. questions for Mr. Nelson. Other than the fact that we used to have quite a few projects in our six-year plan, and now we have four?
Yes, we're trying to keep it as funded as possible while not putting projects on the plan that we can't fully fund. So everything that you've got on the plan is being funded throughout the 6 years, so once projects come off the list, we add projects on the list.
Okay. Motion would be in order, if there are no other questions.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Second. Motion made by Mr. Underwood and seconded by Mr. Taylor to approve the secondary system six-year plan. All in favor? And the resolution we have in our packet. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, nay. The motion carries unanimously. Thank you again, Mr.
Thank
Nelson.
Thank you very much.
We will get you the resolution as soon as possible. Thank you. All right, Mr. Fincham. Agenda item number 5, Heflin Leslie. The zoning from RP to M1.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, your next public hearing tonight is RZ01-2014. Leslie Heflin, owner and applicant, is requesting a rezoning from RP, Rural Preservation, with a density of one dwelling unit per 10 acres of land, to M1 Industrial with proffers on tax map 108-A-44, which consists of approximately 1.75 acres of land. Property is located at 32361 Richmond Turnpike, approximately a third of a mile south of the Route 30 intersection in a Reedy Church voting district. The proposed use would be industrial, specifically minor auto repair establishments, as allowed in the M1 zoning district. The 2030 comprehensive plan identifies the area as being located in the Dawn land use plan and designated for plan development. The applicant is requesting the rezoning to establish, or I should say reestablish, a minor auto repair facility in what was formerly the Gwathney gas station and auto repair site. The property has been dormant and unused for a number of years, and a rezoning to allow this use to be reestablished would bring an existing vacant property back into productive business and industrial use. The applicant has proffered out a number of uses on this site, which staff and the Planning Commission felt were incompatible with the area. VDOT has identified the improvements required. The Health Department does have questions about the well. A new well would have to be drilled if the old well is, in fact, determined to be contaminated. There was a functioning sewage disposal system on the site at one time. That system can be used, provided no significant repairs or upgrades are needed. If that facility is not deemed to be adequate, then connection to the Dawn wastewater system would be required by county ordinance. The Planning Commission forwarded this request to the board with a recommendation of approval.
All right, thank you, Mr. Fincham. Board members, at this time, have any questions for Mr. Fincham? No questions. Thank you, Mr. Fincham. We will declare the public hearing for RZ01-2014 to be open. I take it you're the applicant?
Yes, sir.
Would you like to speak?
Just thank you guys for all your time and effort that's been put into all this. Been waiting patiently and hope everything goes through, and hopefully I'll be able to provide employment for somebody that's unemployed in the community down there. That's about it. I appreciate it.
Thank you, sir. Is there anyone else who would like to speak?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and fellow board members. My name is David Brown. I own property adjacent to this property. I've owned property quite a few years. I'm here to support the applicant of this property. I think that, as a matter of fact, I wholeheartedly support his request, because I think it'd be an asset to the community. Like the gentleman said, the property has been there for a number of years, dominant, and certainly any rezoning or any preparation that can be done to upgrade the property would be highly desirable. And I fully support Mr. Heffley in this endeavor.
Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who would like to speak regarding this matter? Is there anyone else who would like to speak regarding this matter? Is there anyone else who would like to speak regarding this matter? Hearing none, public hearing is declared closed. Mr. Underwood?
I have one.
Yes. Oh, question, Mr. Seeley?
Just one.
Okay.
My only question is, in the sheriff, under the agency and department comments, had one question, are they going to have records? Mr. Fincham, as M1, that is permissible, correct? Tow lot?
A tow service operation with the records is a permitted use in the M1 district, and that has not been proffered out. A tow storage lot would still require a special exception permit from the Board of Supervisors.
Okay.
So what you're saying is he could have a record, but he's got to tow the truck, tow the cars or whatever he tows somewhere else.
He could have a record and a very limited number of vehicles on site for a limited period of time.
Right.
The more extended tow storage lot, which requires or which allows a longer period of storage on site, would still require a use permit from the board.
Okay.
For short term.
Mr. Underwood?
Mr. Chairman, I'm familiar with this Boston property.
Turn your mic on.
I'm familiar with the property here on Route 30. It was used for auto repair years ago, probably 25 years ago at least, I'm sure. I think it's rebuilding of a community. Would be an asset to the community. With that said, I'm going to ask the board members to support me in approving this rezoning to RZ01-2014.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Underwood, seconded by Mr. Akers. No more discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. The motion carries unanimously. Mr. Fincham, special exception 04-2013.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, your next public hearing is SPEX 04-2013, Aggregate Industries Land Company Incorporated, owner Barden Incorporated, applicant, requesting a special exception permit in accordance with Article 17, Section 13, and Article 4, Section 5.3 of the zoning ordinance. On tax parcel 97-A-70A, which containing approximately 200 acres of land. The property is located on the north side of Route 600, Frog Level Road, at the King William County line. The property is located in the Bowling Green Voting District. The proposed use is a special exception permit for sand and gravel extraction and sales. The 2030 Comprehensive Plan designates this area as agricultural preservation with a density of one dwelling unit per 25 acres of land. The applicant is requesting the approval of the special exception permit to allow sand and gravel extraction on the subject parcel. The special exception is to allow an expansion of an existing sand and gravel operation across the county line in King William County. The granting of the special exception would allow the existing sand and gravel operation approximately 10 years of additional life at their current location. The special exception application would not involve the relocation of any equipment from King William County. The facility would remain in King William County. The facility would also not generate any additional traffic on Route 600, as the sand and gravel operation is already in existence on the abutting property. The existing entrance to the facility would be used at their current location in King William County. No additional entrances would be constructed at the site. The existing gated farm entrance could be used as an emergency entrance. You have a letter from Beasley Concrete, which was placed at your desk prior to the start of the meeting. You also have the updated phasing plan that was prepared by the applicant in response to Planning Commission questions at their hearing. The Planning Commission did review the special exception request and forwarded this application to the board with a recommendation of approval subject to the conditions contained in your staff report.
Board members, have any questions, Mr. Fincham, at this time?
Yeah. Generally speaking, when we have requests like this to come before the board, somewhere in the report, it's estimated as to the benefit it would be to Caroline County, whether it be financial or whatever the case may be. And generally for these type of operations, it's an equipment that's housed on site.
Yes, sir.
I haven't seen anywhere in here where it gives me any numbers as to what benefit would be to Caroline County.
I believe the applicant is going to address that issue. That issue was discussed with the applicant. You are correct. Generally, the economic benefit to the county is in the form of the machinery and tools taxes that we collect on the equipment. The issue here is that the equipment is not proposed to be relocated. So I believe the applicant will address that this evening.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Akers. Mr. Fincham, the applicant is here?
Yes, sir.
All righty, let's have him address that. We will declare the public hearing to be opened.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, and staff. I'm going to insert my
PowerPoint in here. Very short.
Probably not. This is off. Now it's on.
Thank you for the technical moment. My name is John Lane. I'm with McGuire Woods here on behalf of the applicant, Allied Land Company. Also have with me tonight representatives of Allied Land Company and representatives of the engineering group who can address questions and fill in some information as needed. And Mr. Tim Bavard will speak directly to your economic question to talk about the indirect and direct impacts. What I'd like to do is just briefly give a short presentation about the project itself and how it meets the standards for a special exception. And essentially, I think the most important thing about this project is that it's an existing plant that has been, this operation, the sand and gravel extraction operation, has been ongoing for approximately 15 years in this location. The fact that the processing plant will remain in its existing location is because it's essentially running out of materials on the King William side of the property to be mined, so they're just going to move across the county line and bring the material back to the existing processing plant, which won't get closer to any other neighbors and will be the same character of the processing as existed before. Similarly, production will be the same because this is just replacement minerals, not additive sand and gravel. And then another very important factor, I believe, is that the fact that, you know, trucks are often a big concern with mining sand and gravel cases. But in this case, traffic will remain the same. No new road entrances are necessary. It's just going to move internally from the mined area to the processing plant and then out the same exit. And here's you have these maps, but for the public as well, here's a map showing the property. The new property is outlined in black. The existing plant is up to the right, and the road will just go diagonally up to the right, to the back of that plant. And so there won't be any entrances out the front of the property, other than there's an existing farm entrance there that will be remain only to be used for emergency access. And we spent a few months working with staff and neighbors talking about concerns, and think we have, with the conditions that have been recommended that we accept, we think we have a project that will meet the requirements of the county ordinance and comprehensive plan. The standards, just to run through them, first, that the use won't adversely affect the character and established pattern of the area, and in this case, as an existing operation, the use has been there for 15 years. Nothing about the character of this area is going to change when the new mining operations start. Second standard, that shall be in harmony with uses permitted by right under the permit in the zoning districts. It shall not adversely affect the use of neighboring properties. Again, this use wouldn't interfere with any other permitted uses within this district, which is rural preservation. The neighbors, because of the buffers, the agreement on limiting hours, the ability to phase, we've changed our phasing plan so that we're working away from the nearest neighbor so that the immediate impact to him will be the go away the fastest. We don't believe that there will be any unreasonable adverse effects for neighboring properties. There are third standard about location and height of buildings, et cetera, at fences. There's going to be no buildings there, no permanent structures at all on the property. So this really isn't an applicable standard. The use shall not adversely affect the health or safety of persons residing or working in the neighborhood of the proposed use. Again, this has been going on for 15 years. Nothing really about it will change. The King William County had been notified. They have not had problems with the existing use. And finally, number five, the use should not be detrimental to the public health, safety, or welfare, or injurious to property or improvements in the neighborhood. Again, sounding like a broken record, but an existing use, it's been there, won't change the character around it. It hasn't caused problems in the years that it's been there, and we don't expect that it would, the use as it would go forward would cause any problems to property or improvements in the area. Ordinance requires that the use be in accordance with the zoning regulations and the comprehensive plan. We believe, again, with conditions recommended by staff, sand and gravel extraction is a permitted use with a special exception in this zoning category. The conditions are designed to do exactly what they do, which is make sure it meets the standards, and we have accepted those conditions and believe they've been worked out with the neighbors and resolve most of the issues that come up with a use like this. And then with respect to the comprehensive plan, this area is designated to be in the agricultural preservation land use plan, or as its use, post-mining. Reclamation is done as the mining occurs. Post-reclamation, crops can be planted, pasture land can be used, so this will remain open space. Question of whether...
You want to summarize, because you've gone past your 5 minutes. So you want to summarize?
I can summarize to say, number seven, we have plenty of utilities and drainage and parking, and we would just request that you ask us any questions you'd like. I'd like for Mr. Rivard to have a moment to give the direct economic impacts, and have some time later to answer questions. Thank you.
We will give you the opportunity to answer questions, and if you'd like to come up and... You gave the lawyer 5 minutes. He gets to go first. Now you only get three.
I only get three.
Right.
Good afternoon, or good evening, Mr. Chairman and the board. My name's Tim Bavard with Aggregate Industries. I'm a land manager for the sand and gravel operation. As John mentioned, or the lawyer mentioned, that this site will give us about 10 more years life for the existing operation that we have there at Mattapani. The direct economic benefits is last year the site had 13 employees, and we had a payroll, in direct payroll dollars, it was $767,000 was paid to those 13 employees in direct payroll. That didn't include their 401k matches and healthcare batches. We also have 15 independent haulers that haul our materials from the site, which it keeps them employed, and they are also allowed to go around and access all of the different companies that use our materials. It's a reduced cost of materials in the marketplace having competition of the sand and gravel companies for governmental use, private use, and for industrial purposes. There's tax revenue through real estate taxes, sales taxes, fuel taxes, and mineral taxes that Caroline County would be able to collect on this operation. The mineral tax, I was able to come up with the formula from Ms. Sharon Carter, and overall, over the 10 years, it would create about $94,300 in taxes. So it would be about $9,300 a year over the 10 years. So there is a mineral tax associated with this project. There's local spending by the company employees and haulers. We do buy locally. Our fuel, tires, and equipment is about $300,000 a year for supplies, office supplies, uniforms. The annual stimulus created by this operation of everything that goes on there is about $6.7 million a year is economic stimulus. It comes directly from the operation and the parts and services that we buy. The capital investment in the equipment on the plant site is about $2.5 million. The benefit to the county is having an adequate supply of these types of materials, and competition in the marketplace keeps the prices down for these materials. These materials are used, construction aggregates are used in building schools, roads, homes, foundations, sidewalks, everything that we've been accustomed to in life generally comes from the ground, and these materials are used in the production of ready-mixed concrete and asphalt. Have you not having, or if the county did not have local uses, it's a low-cost, sand and gravel is a low-cost commodity, and the large percentage of the cost of the material is the hauling of the material. If you didn't have materials in and around the marketplace, like you do currently, as we produce today for a local producer, you got a letter from Mr. Ray Beasley, and you had to haul these materials from 50 miles away. They're not locally available, and you have to truck them in. If you had to truck the material in excess of what we truck it today, an additional 40 to 50 miles, a yard of concrete would go up about $7.55 a yard, which is about $75 a load. And if you were building your new school with 5,000 yards of concrete, basically you would add, in direct cost, $37,500 to the cost of that building, just in direct cost of not having these materials in the local marketplace. Another example would be we supply snow sand to VDOT every year. Numerous of our plants make sand for VDOT. The same being true, if you had to haul it in about 50 miles, it would cost you about $5 a ton, additional. And a 10,000-ton order, which would not be unusual for VDOT, and just direct cost, you'd have $50,000 more spent on your snow sand than being able to produce it here and supply it locally.
So did I misunderstand you, and you said you were going to donate sand for the new school?
We would gladly talk to the county about that. I don't know if we could make the donation, but the sand would be available if this project is approved.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody have any? Well, okay. You were the last one to speak. Okay. Would you like to speak, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now he ran over his time, so please don't run over your time. But since he was going to make a donation, I figured I'd let him keep going. You can go longer if you're going to make a donation, too.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Board of Supervisors, my name is Brad Ashley. I reside at 2 West River Road, Ruther Glen. My property is immediately adjacent to this mining operation. I received notice of this special exception in the middle of February of this year. At that point, I got with the planning staff. Ms. Angelina Pitts has been most gracious in working with me. I've worked on numerous occasions through the Planning Commission to try to resolve some of the issues. They were most professional, they were receptive, they listened, and I greatly appreciate that. In addition, Mr. Bavard came down from his home in Merlin to my home to meet with me in my home, and I've also met with him and a number of representatives on site to try to discuss this operation. My family owns just over 200 acres. The site's just a little larger than the proposed special exception here in front of you tonight. Prior to purchasing the property, we did our due diligence. All the property here surrounding me is a wetland directly across in Caroline County. In the 2013 plan, it was one house per 25 acres. Not what's going on in King William, but what was going on in Caroline County. We purchased the property in 2007. I built my home in 2009. My family has over $800,000 invested in this property. That's a lot of money to us. My physical home is 250 yards from this operation. Proposed for mining. More important than that, my property is 150 feet in elevation above the proposal. So I get to look at this mining operation on a 45-degree angle directly from my back porch. The proposed change from agricultural preservation to a mine modestly would impact my property by 15%. That would be over $120,000 directly out of my bottom line worth. During the mining operation, it basically makes my property unsellable. Nobody's going to move out here as I did for peace and quiet to have a mining operation that I have 250 yards from my back porch. It's just devastating to the quality of life of my entire family. That's not what we came here for. And it's not 40 hours, not 50, not 60, but 62 hours a week we get to listen to this. 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Friday, and 7 a.m. till 2 o'clock on Saturday. The roar of the engines, the clang of the metal, the fumes, the dust, I get the whole Monty. Under the existing plant in King William, about three times farther than this, I can be in my bedroom in the morning with everything closed and hear the operation extremely well. So I can't imagine how this will impact me when and if it is approved. It also appears to be somewhat of a violation of your standards for special exception number 3. The special exception will not hinder adjacent or nearby property or impair the value thereof. I can assure you this is going to impair the value of my property. This special exception will not add jobs. This special exception long term, not 10 years, not 2050, will have a negative impact on tax revenue for Caroline County residents. The renewable resources, sand and gravel, will be taken. They can't be renewed. They'll be sold to the highest bidder. The land will no longer perk. Here's a little detail, too. That land will be 17 feet in elevation below where it is right now. And the ponds, they're not really ponds. They're stormwater detention basins. What could go wrong with 150 acres of mine site, 17 feet below the current elevation, going directly into these storm basins, stormwater basins. Then from there it goes into Boot Creek, Maiden Creek, and ultimately the Mattapinap. My purpose here tonight, you've got a decision to make, and I'm not for or against this project, but I do ask you this humbly, and this is my purpose for being here. Frame this operation with a timeline. They've said 10 years. I've heard that from the planning department. I've heard that from Tim Bavard. I think it can be done in 5. It seems like 7.5 is a reasonable split in time. Really, in this time, I can't sell my property. I'm a 62-year-old man. I don't have a whole lot longer to go than that. It's important to me that there is a time limit. Under the existing conditions, it's a five-year limit. And what happens there is aggregates are great people. They're a good company. They are not going to violate the conditions because they have multi-millions of dollars to make. So if they're going to abide by the conditions, and you and I and all of us may or may not be here in 5 years, but I'm asking you to use the power that you have tonight and put a cap on this. If Aggregates wants to mine it, if that's something you think is in the best interest of the citizens in Caroline County, then do it. But do it in 7.5 years and let me get on with my life so I don't have to hear this 62 hours every week on Saturday and smell the fumes and watch the trucks directly from my back porch. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ashley. Is there anyone else who would like to speak regarding this matter? Is there anyone else who would like to speak regarding this matter? Is there anyone else who would like to speak regarding this matter? Hearing none, the public hearing is declared closed. Questions at this point are for Mr. Fincham or the applicant. Ms. Taylor?
Yes. Mr. Fincham.
Yes, sir.
In regards to a cap being placed on the amount of time that this will allow this operation to exist. Right now, there is no cap. Is that right, or is it?
There is no cap on the total length of time. The 10 years was based on the estimate of the volume or the amount of sand in that location. There's a five-year review period, but if the board wants to place a limit on the 7.5, 10 years, a time limit, then yes, you can do that.
Okay. I guess my question would be to the applicant and how the applicant would respond to a cap being placed on this particular project.
You can answer, Mr. Barr. You can answer.
From right here?
You can answer. How do you feel about a cap of 10 years being placed on your project?
Or 7.5.
Okay, or 7.5.
The issue with the cap, because we had talked, because originally I don't think the special exception had even a five-year in it. There's about 5.6 million tons on that particular site. Generally, we will wash about 5 million tons, just short of 5 million tons a year. If you do the math, it's about 10 years. That's why we say originally when we met, it's about a 10-year project. We've just come through one of the worst recessions that we've been in my lifetime, and I can't predict what's going to happen in 5 or 10 years. But if we would develop the site and you put a cap on us, it would be a shame to have a site that you can mine with available material that's permitted that you can't get to. So basically, with the 5.6 million tons, if you put a five-year cap on us or a seven-year cap on us, we're not able to tap all of the reserves there that we would like to get for that facility. So it would be a financial burden to aggregate to go through the process and then leave the available sand and gravel in this particular case.
Okay, I'm sorry, I don't remember your name, sir.
Mr. Ashley.
Mr. Ashley, when did you move, and you probably said this, and I don't remember.
Yes, sir.
When did you purchase
the 2007, property? I purchased the property. In 2009, I built my home. And under 7.5 years, it's only 150 acres to mine because most of the other properties and berms and so forth, I only have a 100-foot buffer where everyone else has 200. But be that as it may, they can mine it. It's only 20 acres a year under 7.5. I could get my John Deere out there and pretty close to do 20 acres a year. But the long and short of it is, if they have to mine it, they can mine it and stockpile it. The only difference is it's 50 cents a ton more is what it costs them. That's the real deal. It's and money just like everything else.
Okay, thank you, sir. I guess my concern is, I do have a concern personally for this gentleman. He lives there. And if he would be willing to cap it, then I might think in terms of it. But I just have a concern for what is, for what his concern is. I wouldn't want to live there. Thank you.
Mr. Black?
Yeah, I just, I have a couple. This is in a, I guess, Mr. Fincham would be the one who would address. This is in a near boot swamp, right? This is in a swamp, near a swamp area, correct?
Yes, sir.
And I guess the question I have for it is, if they're going to be mining, there's going to be a hole going down, correct? I mean, so we're going to be going down deeper than swamp is a low-lying area. So, I mean,
yes.
Am I correct on that?
Yes.
So I guess my question is, and I was just thinking about this in terms of, you got a swamp area. If we have the rains like we had, what effect does that have? Like, we have rains what we had in the past month, month and a half, with that mining operation in a area that's obviously a floodplain and low-lying area.
You will have a period of time where you have a temporary increase, perhaps, in the elevation of your groundwater as well as surface water. The floodplain regulations really speak to construction in a floodplain. They do not speak to excavation in a 100-year floodplain. So our floodplain regulations are not intended to prohibit, restrict, or really even address mineral extraction. It's more about construction of buildings, structures, storage of flammables, etc., in the 100-year floodplain. So the short answer to your question, you may have periods where you have some inundation of land. You may have periods where the groundwater levels increase above what the current groundwater levels are for some period of time. That would be contained within the excavated areas on the site.
And how far down are they going? Just out of curiosity, do we know how many feet down they're going with this extraction?
Well, I think Mr. Ashley indicated that it was going to be about 17 feet below the current elevation of the ground in that area.
Mr. Ashley?
Thank you.
I mean, I can get the exact number for you and go back in the report and get the exact number for you.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Underwood?
Mike, Mr. Fincham, how many sand and gravel operations do we have in the county now?
Can you give me a minute to count my fingers?
Right. So basically, the analogy of driving 50 miles to get sand is out the window, because we don't need to drive 50 miles to get sand, do we?
We have several sand and gravel operations existing or approved in the northern part of the county.
Okay.
I don't believe we have one south of Bowling Green. I believe that's the closest one in Caroline County to this site, would be the one on 301, the Luckstone operation, just south of town.
Yes. Mr. Chairman, my concern, really, as I listen to the gentleman speak about the economic impact to Caroline County, basically I heard $9,400 a year over, and I think the quality of life for Mr. Ashley, 7 years is basically $59,000. I think his quality of life to me is more valuable than that. So I do have some concerns also, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Mr. Akers?
I want to make sure I understood the gentleman here from Harrogate, when he said that Caroline County would benefit from sales taxes as well. Yeah. What are you referring to there?
When you make a sale, it's like any other material. If you're selling,
I understand the process of sales tax.
Yes,
I understand how that works. But I didn't realize that it would apply to what comes out of Caroline County. Well, if you're operating in King William, I did not realize it
I would hope that it would trickle back through the state into the state sales tax, and the state sales tax
that's
back to the county.
Oh, okay.
And the other sales
tax. Don't assume, okay? Because I can tell you, as of today, there's been no budget approved by the General Assembly, so don't assume that at all. Because the chances of that happening are pretty small. Okay, that's it. Thank you.
And we also have a real issue in getting money we send to Richmond to come back, so. That's another
Thank
story.
You.
Mr. Seeley, this is your district. Mike, this is how far from 301? It's going up, it's like 3 miles?
No, it's further than 3 miles.
Oh, eight? Okay.
About.
Mr. Ashley just said 8 miles. Now, Mr. Ashley, you said... during your presentation, you live in King William? Or you live in Caroline?
Mr. Chairman, I have 100 acres in Caroline, 100 in King William. It's crazy. I had to get my building permit out of King William.
Where's your house?
I go to court in Caroline. My house is actually in Caroline County. Okay. But my taxes go to King William. I don't know how it's set up.
Oh, we're going to fix that. Did you say during your presentation, you mentioned $800,000?
Yes, sir.
That was the value of your property?
Of my property and my home.
And your home?
And the improvements I've made to it since I purchased. Yes, sir.
Okay. Because you're going to pay like $6,400 a year in taxes.
I don't doubt that. I have it in preservation right now, so I don't pay quite that much, but it's moving in that direction.
We might fix that, too. But the, I mean, just purely financial.
Yes, sir.
If your house is worth $800,000, our tax rate is 83 cents, it's a little more than $6,400 a year. We're going to get $9,000 a year from aggregate is what they're saying. But your house value may go down. Now, your house value goes down, it's not going to go down $9,000, but we won't realize all of the money they're saying we'll realize because we'll lose a little bit in the devaluing of your house.
Yes, sir, but let me make sure I'm clear here because I do not want to misrepresent this. Okay. I pay taxes to King William County. I have 100 acres in Caroline County and probably a little over 100 in King William.
Your house is in Caroline.
My house is in Caroline, right on the glacier line. And that is some predetermined thing before I move there. This is what I was directed to do, and of course that's what I do. So I don't want to misrepresent that I'm paying X number of dollars to Caroline County, because that's not accurate.
Okay, well, I believe the Commonwealth of Virginia has certain laws that say if your house is in a locality, you have to pay taxes to that locality.
Well,
so we're going to fix that. You don't even have to worry about
that. Yes, sir. That's not my thing.
We're going to fix that part. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. That's it for you. I appreciate it. Why are you getting up?
I was going to ask, may I add one more item?
No, thank you. Mr. Bavard, tell me one more time how much money there's going to be for the county.
Well, directly in the county uses something called the Hoscold method, and it's a method to determine the value of material to convert it to your 83 cents per hundred. And I got this from Mrs. Sharon Carter from the Commissioner of the Revenue.
Right.
Looking at the number of tons that we think are there, using Ms. Carter's formula, the number comes out totally. This would be for the deposit we think's in the ground, $94,354.
For the life of the project?
For the life of the mine.
Okay.
Dividing that by 10.
And that's all, right? Because there's no vehicles you're moving into the county. All that's going to stay in King William.
Well, there would be mining equipment located in Caroline County, but that would be mobile mining equipment.
But that's housed in King William.
It's housed in King William at the time. It would, of course, be on site.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir. Mr. Seeley, your last is in the district you represent.
Mr. Chairman, I spent about an hour and a half looking at the site a couple weeks ago. I looked at the general lay of all the land. I even looked for the houses around, and I know it's May and you can't see them. I looked pretty hard, didn't see a thing. One of the issues, I think, is that Beasley Concrete and some folks that actually live in Caroline County work there. And in this economy, losing jobs is not something that I think is something we can afford to do. The land, I looked at where they would cross Boot Swamp to come across. There's an existing lane. The property that's being mined is already open. I looked at the land that had been mined, the land that was going to be mined. The difference in it is very, very slight when you look at where they were, what they're working in, and what's been reclaimed. I was pretty surprised. Taking all that into account, and we're getting ready to build a school, not sure where our concrete's going to come from.
Oh, they're going to go get sand too.
See, you never know. We might get a good deal on sand for Beasley Concrete and a reduced price on concrete from them. But looking at the general topography and the land use there, I would say that the impact was very, very minimal. And I'll go ahead and make a motion to approve special exception 04-2013 for Aggregate Industries Corporation.
Is there a second to the motion? Is there a second to the motion? And your motion would be to approve aggregate for the duration, 10 years or whatever, or just approve it, period? No limit or without limit?
Without. I'm not sure we've ever been able to place sunsets on anything. So I'm not, without somebody from legal telling us we can do that, because in the past we've been told we can't put sunset clauses, but we do have a five-year review process.
Okay. Was there a second to the motion? Is there a second to the motion? Give you a chance to modify the motion before it dies.
Mr. Chairman, I'll modify the motion to expire in 10 years from the date of the filing of the plan.
Is there a second to that motion? No second? Any other motion?
Mr. Chairman, may I make a suggestion that the, the current property owner right now?
I'm sure hoping it's a yes or no question, but go right ahead. Mr. Ashley?
Yes?
Yeah. No, his, he.
It's not second.
Oh, you're the Jason property. Can I ask you a question?
Yes, sir.
I guess my question is, would you be willing, have you sat down with the company already and talked to them?
Oh, they've been great to work with. I don't want in any way to think that that's any negative reflection on
Ashley.
Mr. Bart came in from Maryland to my home.
That was a yes or no
question. Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me.
Have you sat down
with
him?
I have met with him, yes, sir.
Thank you.
Would you be willing to continue to work with them?
Certainly.
Mr. Chairman, let me do this. Can I table this and have further discussion with both aggregate and staff and bring this up at our first meeting in...
You have that courtesy.
July.
July? You withdraw your motion.
Withdraw my motion.
And he's making a motion. Well, we actually provide that courtesy, so if... It's in his district. He's making a motion to defer. A request to defer, we automatically defer it. I don't see any need to do that because I think most of the board would concur with deferral. So, and that's our common courtesy because we're civilized here. So, all right, first meeting in July?
Yes.
All right. Okay. Thank you, gentlemen. We will discuss that again. Mr. Fincham, we'll move on to special exception 01-2014, Trimmer, Thomas Lee, and SIG Acquisitions.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, your next public hearing is SPEX 01-2014, Thomas Trimmer Owner, SIG Acquisition Company, LLC Applicant, requesting a special exception permit in accordance with Article 17, Section 13, and Article 12, Section 2 of the Caroline County Zoning Ordinance on Tax Map 82-80-105. Requesting a special exception permit to allow a reduction in the minimum yard requirements for a public utility. The subject property is located at 10,257 Patterson Lane, Route 715 in the Mattapony Voting District. Again, the proposed use is an exemption from the minimum lot size requirement in the RP District and to allow a modification to the rear setback. The 2030 comprehensive plan identifies this area as the Carmel Church Community Plan and designated for commercial and office uses. The applicant is requesting approval for the special exception permit to modify the minimum lot size and setback requirements for
a proposed parcel acres in size to allow the location of fiber optic cable shelters and a backup generator. The proposed regeneration facility generally are located every 60 miles to serve as boosters for the fiber optic cables. The cables are sensitive to elements and require shelters and HVAC units for these proposed facilities. A backup generator would also be constructed to ensure continuous power for the fiber optics. The site would be surrounded by a chain link fence to limit access to the site and a single entrance off of Patterson Avenue. The facility would be unmanned, and the backup generator would be started approximately once a week for 30 minutes to ensure its operation. The location was chosen because of its proximity to the 95 corridor and the fiber optic lines in the area. Planning Commission held its public hearing on the request and forwarded a recommendation of approval to the board. With that, I'll address any questions that you may have.
Questions for Mr. Fincham at this time? None. Mr. Fincham, this isn't some sort of internet site. It's just a backup fiber optic station?
Yes, sir. It's not an actual, it's really a booster station is what it is, and power backup in the event of a failure.
Thank you, sir. Is the applicant here? Let me declare the public hearing to be open first. The public hearing is open. Would you be Mr. Trimmer?
My name is Philip Hosack. I'm with SIG Acquisition.
Okay. Go right ahead, sir.
a little bit about the site itself. I don't know if you are familiar with this particular area, but this is a cul-de-sac dead-end street that abuts the 95 corridor. Our fiber optic cable is actually following the 95 right-of-way. I-95 right-of-way in VDOT. As part of a resource sharing agreement with VDOT, that basically means they get facilities to operate their ITS, their intelligent transportation system through our fiber. The regen site itself has indicated it's a booster site, about every 60 miles to improves a signal. What else can I say about the site? An idea of what it looks like, I'm sure you've all seen cell sites, and there's a brown aggregate concrete shelter. That's what it looks like, without the tower. There will be no towers at this site. The site will be screened with natural pine trees. You probably won't even see it. The only noise that will come out of it about once a week will be their generator starting up and shutting down. Okay. Do you have any questions regarding the site?
Well, thank you. Let me see if there's anybody else who would like to speak, and then we'll come back and ask you questions.
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir. Is there anyone else who would like to speak? Is there anyone else who would like to speak regarding this matter? Is there anyone else who would like to speak? Hearing none, we'll declare the public hearing closed. Any questions? No questions? Seems like a fairly simple operation. It's no impact. There's really no revenue, but it's... is there any revenue? Do we get some machinery or tools or...
There is no real revenue, although I did meet with your economic development folks, and we're right across 95 from the new development, and he felt that the availability of the fiber might be, an enhancement to the project. So.
But you're not the only fiber running up and down 95.
No, we're not. No, we are the only ones on 95.
You are the only fiber on 95?
Yes, we are. Yes, we are.
And the purpose of your fiber is just to connect to VDOT's IDS system?
No, it's a private.
It's a private.
We are a CLEC. We are a public utility. But VDOT, for allowing us to utilize the right-of-way, they have a benefit out
in
of it
turn,
as well.
In turn, you provide them?
Correct.
Okay. Now, how would I tap into your fiber to provide, say, internet access to a couple of buildings that are along there?
Contact my sales folks, and they will... We could build to it from our shelter or a place point along the route. But I mean, it's you can get to the fiber if there's a need for it.
Okay, is that a possibility? I mean,
oh yeah, that's
it's probably more of a possibility before we approve it than after we approve it. But that's beside the point.
No. That's what it's there for use.
Do you have a business card by any chance?
I do.
Would you give it to Mr. Parton? Mr. Parton, would
Absolutely.
You?
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
Sure.
All right. No other questions? This is Madam Pena. I don't really see anything. I'd appreciate a motion to approve it.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion we approve special exception 01-2014. Trimmer Thomas Lee, owner for SIG Acquisition Company, applicant.
Second.
All right, motion made by Mr. Seeley, seconded by Mr. Akers. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. The motion carries unanimously. We've done 8. Are we still doing 9, the Country Fest?
They are here.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, your next item on the agenda, which is not a public hearing, is a request for approval of a festival permit, administrative permit 01-2014 for the proposed Country Fest at the Meadow. Commonwealth Fairs and Events has submitted a request for what is planned to be an annual concert at the Meadow Event Park. The first such event would be June 28th of this year. You may have heard this advertised at various radio stations as the K95 Country Fest. In accordance with Chapter 49 of the County Code, as well as the proffers accepted with the rezoning for Meadow Event Park, a festival permit is required for any music festival not associated with the state fair at this site. The purpose of this permit request is to fulfill the requirements of both the festival permit and the zoning on the property to allow this event to go forward. The applicant appears to have complied with all the standards set forth in the festival permit. Staff recommends approval of this request. I'll address any questions that the board may have.
Thank you, Mr. Fincham. Board members have any questions of Mr. Fincham at this time? If not, thank you, Mr. Fincham. We will declare the public hearing to be open.
This is not a public hearing.
Just on a public hearing roll. All right, the applicant's here. Would you like to add something?
Good evening, Chairman, members of the board. Thank you for taking a few minutes to listen to us this evening. Have you had an opportunity to review our festival application? I think probably the best thing at this point then would be for me to answer any of your questions. I'm certainly happy to review the event, but in the essence of time, and since you have already had the opportunity to review the application, I don't need to repeat that unless you have specific questions.
Yeah, you're basically using you're replacing one event with this event, right? Is that what we understand?
No, that's not quite it. So maybe I better just take a few minutes of your time this evening and give you a little bit of an overview. This is the first of two festival permits that have been submitted to the county for your consideration. This is one under the current zoning, as Mr. Fincham mentioned. There has been a second festival permit submitted that would be considered if the rezoning application were to be approved on June 10th. The only difference between the two applications is the location of the two music stages. In this application, the stages are, according to the proffers, located in the northern end of the Midway parking area and inside of the Farm Bureau Center Exhibition Hall. So that is the only difference between these two applications. The event, this is the first year it will be held at the Meadow Event Park. As Mr. Fincham said, it will be Saturday, June 28th. This is a full afternoon and evening music festival. Gates would open at 11 a.m. Music would start at noon and run for 8 hours until 8 p.m. At the conclusion of the music, we will have a bull ride and a barrel race in the horse and livestock complex of the Meadow. And besides the music and the bull rides, we'll have a country fest playground where we have inflatable water slides, mechanical bulls, that sort of thing, as well as 30 food and retail vendors who have already signed up to participate in the event. So there is the revenue potential there through Commissioner Brevner's office, and Ms. Carter has already received a preliminary list of those vendors. We anticipate attendance at this event at being 10,000. Ticket sales are already occurring online. They are $25 in advance, $35 at the gate. There is a military and a child discount price as well as a VIP option, and all this can be found on the website for the event, k95countryfest.com, which also allows customers the opportunity to go check out the festival policies, learn about the schedule, so they know what to expect before their arrival at the Meadow. One thing, especially after Chief Loftus's presentation earlier, I think is important to note is a comprehensive public safety, an emergency management plan and manual has been put together and from input from county agencies. This plan includes traffic control, interior and exterior law enforcement, fire and EMS, weather contingencies, an operational timeline, and a unified command staff protocol. Mr. Chris Alberta is the security lead for this event. Mr. Alberta is here and can address any questions that you might have about emergency management or security plans for the event. In addition to him, we have been working with Caroline County Fire and Rescue and EMS, the Sheriff's Office, Virginia State Police, Virginia Alcoholic Beverage Control, and private companies, ETS Incorporated for EMS services, as well as RMC events, which have been integral already in the planning for public safety for this event. Additionally, we have filed an ABC permit application, the land use permit and traffic control plan. The primary parking area for this event will be Lot C, which is the area south of the horse and livestock complex accessed off of Meadow Farm Road. General customers will all enter through the main ticket plaza. This gives us the opportunity to remind them of the festival policies as well as conduct bag checks. The majority of the festival layout is north of Route 30, around the Farm Bureau Exhibition Hall and around the Meadow Hall Mansion. The vendors will be laid out outside around the festival loop in front of the exhibition hall. As I mentioned earlier, the stage locations for this application are the northern end of the Midway and inside of the exhibition hall. They will alternate music on those two stages. They will not have concurrent music on both of them. And we are definitely wanting to keep that music under 8 hours, even under this festival permit consideration. Then the bull ride and the barrel race will happen in Ring 1, which is in the horse and livestock complex south of 30. May I answer any questions?
I have a couple. You said that one stage would be inside the Farm Bureau building?
Yes, sir.
And then the other in the loop, I guess. Is that correct?
No, this is under the current zoning. So mm-hmm. Before the proffers are changed, the proffers currently state that a festival stage outside of the State Fair of Virginia event must be in the northern part of the Midway parking.
Correct.
So this is This is not our first choice for a stage location, but it is what the property is zoned for currently. We do have some concerns about putting a stage on asphalt in June, so we would prefer that it be located in Festival Loop on grass.
Okay. Have to come back with the proffer amendment to do that.
Yes, sir.
So, and Mr. Cully said that was set for June 10th. So basically what we're doing now, and staff has recommended approval because all of this is according to your existing proffers.
Yes, sir.
So, Mr. Underwood.
Okay.
Yeah, there will be a public hearing June 10th. You've advertised this. There's nothing we're going to do to say, no, you can't have it. Travis Tritt's coming and whoever else.
Yes.
So the only issue you have is when you come back on June 10th to say, we would like to move this somewhere else, then that may or may not happen, but you're still going to have this festival.
Correct. That's what we would like to do.
Right. Well, you're going to do that. You just may have asphalt, a stage in July or June.
And we will make adequate public safety contingency plans for that if that's what we must do.
Okay. So that's the worst case. But okay. Any other questions? All right. I didn't really see any action. There's no action. We need to, it doesn't say discussion and direction by staff. That's what you say.
Festival permits are required to be approved by the Board of Supervisors. This is consistent with the zoning, and in and of itself, by the zoning conditions, it requires a festival permit to be granted by the board in accordance with Chapter 49.
So action would
the purpose of the proffers was to make sure that if there was an outdoor concert, it was brought for the board so that you were aware of the parameters of that concert in conjunction with Chapter 49.
Okay. Will they have to come back? I'm sorry. Will they have to come back after June 30th to get another festival permit, or will this permit carry them through the amended proffers?
No. If they amend the proffers in June.
If the board amends the proffers in June 10th.
Yes. They would have to come back with another festival permit application. We have that application. We're bringing that forward with the rezoning. You could not consider the new application at this point in time because it's based upon the revised proffers.
She had everything. If the conditions were met under this particular proffer, why would she have to come back and get a festival permit for the amended proffers is what I was getting at.
Because they would be, they'd be a different layout, so you'd have to reapprove that new layout.
All right. Mr. Chairman, I'm always kind of between a rock and a hard place because I get some of the calls regarding the noise from activity at Metal Event Park. I do understand it is a certainly generates revenue for the county, and I try my best to look at it from both perspectives, from the business perspective and in terms of the business owners in the county as well as the residents. I just wish there was some way we could come to a happy median, because I do believe there's a way, but we haven't gotten there yet. I do have some concerns that have been voiced to me at our last constituent meeting. And once we allow the festival, then certainly it could become a frequent activity there at the Meadow, which are some concerns of some of the residents. So I do have some concerns, but I'm just kind of caught in the middle, to tell you honest truth.
Well, we need to...
I'm going to take Mr. Underwood out of the middle and make a motion that we approve the festival permit based on what, Chapter 49, Article 49, what is it?
Existing proffers.
Second. I'm sorry? Chapter 49.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Akers, seconded by Mr. Black. Further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay.
Nay.
Motion carries 5-1. Mr. Underwood is the dissenting vote. Bless you. Okay, Mr. Cully, information and calendar items. Agenda item 10. Oh, did I miss Relay for Life?
That was Saturday.
That would be a yes. Okay. Oh, I went to a funeral. I couldn't have made it any other
difference.
Thanks for all your help.
You will note that I'll be on vacation next week.
Oh, man. How many vacations do you get?
A few. I'll be
Carlisle.
I can't help when these national events are scheduled.
Pennsylvania?
Pennsylvania.
Oh, yes. Home of Jim Thorpe.
In the 2-on-2, had asked that we look at scheduling a water work session.
Yes.
Planning. So I put that on the calendar for folks to see for the 24th. Everybody would mark that on their calendar. We're preparing a water master plan, sort of work session, planning session. Mr. Sheeble's working on those.
Can we meet the 4th? That's the 4th Tuesday in June. And I know we only have one meeting on the even months. You know? But we are going to talk about some of your stuff, too. We could, you and... Yeah, we're talking water planning. It's like a water work session, where we are, what we have, especially with Lake Caroline possibly coming off, and what we do with that capacity, and where we're going to get water, the Rappahannock thing. So kind of solidify a few more things, the Caroline Pines, when it's going to kick in. Week of the night? Of June night? Oh. Well, we got a board meeting on the 10th.
Yes, we're pushing. That'll probably be pushing utilities to get the information together. That's why we sort of pushed it out. July would be. The 15th. Tuesday's the 15th.
You mean regular board meeting? Oh.
Oh, that's the second week of July. Yeah, that'd be the 8th is the regular board meeting.
How much time do you think we need? I mean, we could do it in phases, but that's not going to be really productive. We could have Mr. Sheeble come by for an hour before the board meeting and then do another one. Yeah, well, we can meet the 24th and then we'll plan on some other things around Ms. Akers. Not there, you know. Turn that water off and make out my phone.
The other meeting that you had asked was the 22nd of July, which is the second meeting in July, 4:30 with the school board. The 2-on-2 had made that recommendation.
Right.
Just put that out there. It's ways away, but maybe you could start planning that on your calendar for.
There was a couple of things we wanted to follow up. The maintenance part, joint maintenance, so we could save some money. Of course, talk about the school project and to figure out, you know, as early as possible some budget implications. If they're adding 14 classes at the high school, they'll probably be adding 14 teachers. So we're going to have to look at some budget things. We might as well see them as soon as possible. All right, that was it?
Yes, sir, that's it.
Thank you, sir. All right, now we're going to go into, I got two of them.
Can you do closing board comments?
Closing board comments. Mr. Taylor, closing board comments?
I don't have any, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Black?
None, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Underwood?
No, sir, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Akers?
No, sir.
Mr. Seeley?
No, sir, Mr. Chairman.
All right, I have one. I have got to thank Mrs. Pam Hall for her help. For the family who had a funeral this weekend, she did a great job of working with me, trying to coordinate things. So, Pam, thanks again. As always, you do a great job. We do appreciate it. I appreciate it. All right, close the meeting, I got two. We need a motion for consultation with legal counsel and briefing by staff, section 2.23711A7 of the Code of Virginia, regarding specific legal matters requiring legal advice regarding the collection of amounts due to the county related to sale of water to Ladysmith Water Company, and the acquisition and disposition of real property, section 2.23711A3 of the Code of Virginia, to discuss potential acquisition by the county of certain real property near the wastewater treatment plant and granting of an easement requested by Columbia Gas, where discussion in open meeting would adversely affect the county's bargaining position or negotiating strategy. Is there a motion to that effect, please?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
So, motion carries. We are now in closed meeting. We will reconvene. Motion to come out of closed session.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Second.
Motion
second.
Made by Mr. Seeley, seconded by Mr. Akers. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Mr. Taylor, do you certify that only those things we went into closed meeting were discussed?
I so certify.
Mr. Black?
I so certify.
Mr. Underwood?
I so certify.
Mr. Akers?
I so certify.
Mr. Seeley?
Mr. Chairman, I so certify.
And I so certify. We have no action from the to direct
to
approve the settlement agreement?
No, the deed of easement.
Ah. We need a motion to approve the deed of easement for
to approve the agreement and then direct the county administrator and attorney to finalize the document.
So moved.
Thank you.
Second.
All right. Motion made by Mr. Taylor, seconded by Mr. Akers. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. That motion carries unanimously. Motion to adjourn is in order.
So moved.
Second.
Adjourned.